So, welcome everyone again, those who just joined. My name is Arvind Naik and I'll be talking about spirituality-centered leadership. Now, when you think about leadership, what are the characteristics that come to your mind? Anyone wants to share? What are the things, that qualities that come to your mind? What would you like to see in a great leader?
Decision making.
Okay.
Responsibility,
like ownership, taking the ownership. Okay.
Courage.
The courage to do something big.
Vision.
Having a vision. Beautiful.
Taking a risk.
Ability to take risk. Okay. Not afraid. Basically, fear. Kind of fearlessness.
Doing the right thing,
that's important. I mean, you can have all of this and you may be going the wrong direction, that's not going to help. So, yes, great thing, yes. Passion, compassion, okay. Yeah, passion is also there, but you're talking about compassion. Compassionate for human beings, compassionate in general, okay. Anyone else?
Ability to listen.
Okay. Listening, very good. Arun, you said something? Higher moral standards, something a little bit better than all of us if you want to see something higher. Okay, great. See, all you already knew this, then why do I think I have to come here? All right, now we'll connect that to spirituality. The misconception about leadership out there, or even in us, when you reflect in the quietness of our time and we were trying to not get influenced by others, we usually come up with the right answers. But in general, think about leader. We think about someone who is leading others. Right? Someone leading others. That's what we call misconception number one. Because nobody can lead others. Only they can lead themselves. Second misconception is that if you want to be a leader, you need followers. Otherwise, how can you be a leader? If you're alone and you have all these characteristics, could you be a leader? You can't? Or you can? The misconception is that we need also followers. If there are no followers, so people try to collect followers. And that's a problem. Because not necessarily followers come for the right reasons. And the third misconception out there is we should look good. It should look good. We want to make sure that it doesn't ruffle the feathers of many people, otherwise they will not follow me. And it's kind of tight. So these are the things that we generally think, and then I'm going to just focus on them as not the right kind of characteristics. The right characteristic, which you all called out, is the vision, having a vision, having compassion, so having awareness of the need, awareness of what the challenge is today, right? As a leader who says, no, everything is fine right now, so then you may say, well, maybe sure, I'm not sure if you are the right leader. So having a full awareness of the current challenges and opportunities is something a leader should have. And then we talked about courage and risk taking and all that, but it basically means someone who can have the vision to change and also can bring about the change, or what we say transformation. A small change is not what we're talking about. Leadership is about bringing transformation. Bringing something totally new. Something, as Arvind said, something setting some higher standard. Now, how do you give these characteristics? And where do you find them? Is there a place where it is sold in retail? Is there a cost to it? Is it available out there somewhere in a book that you can read and you get it? Is there somewhere, is someone distributing it freely and or with a cost? Where do you find these characteristics? Anyone? I know, I told you, I'm going to be talking to you.
Hope is in the willingness from
within. It's within?
Willingness.
It's a willingness from within. Okay, that's
educate
nice.
Educating yourself.
Educating yourself. Okay? By serving other leaders.
Observing
other leaders. Okay, observation.
If you see someone
that you think is a yes. So being observant would be a good characteristic. But then you also need two things. One is a role model in front of you. And second, your ability to observe. Or to observe the right kind of, because everyone has all kinds of characteristics, and you may get stuck in their looks. Or sometimes they wear a good dress and you like their dress. And there you go, I want that dress because they look cool in that. So you have to observe the right characteristics that we talk about. What else can somebody, where do we find these? So ability to observe, ability to educate or reflect. Someone's, Narvi said, within. Where else do you find these characteristics? How do you grow these characteristics if they lie dormant in us? Or how one grows?
Life experience.
Life experience helps you grow. Okay, that's a good one. Anyone else? So everybody who is 100 year old should be having all these characteristics, right? Should they have 100 years of life experience? Is that true?
You could do personal development courses.
Personal development courses. Oh, great. That's a good one. So education, educating yourself, throwing yourself out there to learn. Laura, you had something to say? Yeah.
You have to somehow overcome the fear.
You have to overcome the fear. Fear of what?
Fear is what prevents most people from taking mutual
assistance. Fear of something prevents you from going out there and doing something. Yeah. Very valid point. Yours?
Raising your spiritual awareness.
Raising your spiritual awareness. Oh, that one was the kind of answer I was looking for. Good one. So, that's where, you know, you see the struggle. It's not something that you can, now, yes, you can educate yourself, but if the schools have been already teaching leadership and all these characteristics, everybody come out of school should have been a great leader already, right? Or there was a course leadership 101 that I can take for a week or two, and I come out of there and I'm ready to lead the whole country to a new direction. But if those who are teaching, they should have been already presidents or the leaders that in your view, right? Is that true? You see the challenge? The challenge is that it is not, these characteristics cannot be learned through the convention and traditional methods of education. They cannot be learned by paying money, by paying somebody tuition fees, and then they teach you, and now you are courageous and risk-taking. Or now you are all of a sudden having higher moral standards, and all of a sudden you can have a vision. These come from within. This comes from within. And within us, now I'll come to the kind of the meat of the discussion, or the veggie of the discussion, because I'm visiting. All of the inspiration is lying dormant within each one of us. We are essentially spirits who are having human experience. The saints teach us spirituality, the essence of spirituality is that not that we learn spirituality, not that we go to some place and learn it. We're already spiritual. We just have forgotten it. We're actually a spiritual being having human experience. Very different approach to all the problem. One way to solve it is I don't know, and so someone knows and I have to go and learn from them, right? I don't know, I don't have it, someone has it, and I have to go to them, and either they ask something in reward or something in exchange, or they are gracious to give it free. And that's how the material world works, but not the spiritual world. How do you recognize the divinity, the spirit that already exists? What is the meaning of spirit? what are the characteristics of spirit when we think about spirit? So first, there was a speaker who came just a few weeks back, and he gave a talk in library, and he was giving a talk about spirituality and meditation, and he asked the question, who are we? Are we body? Are we mind? Or are we, do we have spirit? So people haven't came up with many answers. That, yeah, I have a body. I think many of you realize that we have a body, right? That's why you're here. You had to carry it all the way here, sitting in a car, driving it. We also have a mind, right? We have a mind that is logical, sometimes artistic, creative. It can be trained. It thinks. Sometimes it thinks you don't want to think, but it thinks. It is a tool that is available to us. But do you think that you are the mind? You have the mind. Because when you say, I have a monkey mind, and many people go, I can't stop it. You can't say that I'm a monkey and, you know, I say, I have a mind. We have a mind. So, do we have a soul? So do we have a soul? Anybody who says, who has soul here? Everybody's kind of agreed with that, you have soul? Okay, so the answer this lady gave is, this is wrong. She said, I don't have a soul. She said, I am a soul. See the difference? You don't have soul. If you had soul, it's like a money in the pocket that you can spend and you can get rid of. Or at times you don't have it. But you are soul. You are the spirit or the Atman. In our Hindu tradition we call it Atman. You are that. And what is the soul? Where is the soul coming from? Being a soul, what does it mean to you that you're a soul? What does it mean to you? Let's look at the characteristics of soul. Soul is a drop of the ultimate unlimited consciousness, what we call God. So being a drop of that consciousness, it has everything, every characteristic that God has. So you have access to God right there and there. And this knowledge is that words I'm describing, this relationship between soul and God, it's very simple. At the same time, it is very mystical. So many of the saints and spiritual teachers give various examples to explain this relationship. How do they explain? They say, we are child, I'm a child, and God is the father or mother. Some people like the mother, and God is really not mother or father, it's the parent, doesn't have a gender. And it's okay to call him mother, it's okay to call or her mother, or it's okay to call him father. So some people use that analogies. Other people use the analogy of lover and beloved. You know, the story of Radha and Krishna. There's a very great analogy many times people explain. Then the soul is like the Radha and the Krishna is the God. And the stories are made to kind of explain you this relationship. Some people call him eternal friend. In fact, if you dig deeper into the Vedic scriptures or even in fact any spiritual scripture from any religion, they say actually there is no difference. You're already that. So this is to for the mind to say, well, how can I be God? I mean, I don't have any powers. I can just control a little bit of what I can do, not even everything. So how can I be God? I don't have any of that. I don't see any, or I don't experience any powers. But you are. And that's the spirit, that's the realization that saints and mystics have come up with. So if you are God, and you are God, and you are God, are you separate gods? What's the difference between all of us? If you are Atman, you are the soul, and you are the spirit, and you are the Roop, and whatever name we call it. What is the difference? Can there be a difference in one soul to another soul? Is there a difference between the drops that fall from the rain, other than they're falling here and there? It's the rain, the same water, right? There is no difference. We are all actually one. And this fact, this is truth, is not something that can be learned. It is to be realized. So the saints are telling, we are already soul, we are already spirit, we are already part of God. Or you can say, the only difference is, we are kind of God trapped in this body and the mind. And it just doesn't know, forgotten itself. That part of God is forgotten itself. It's like a wave of things that's separate from the ocean. You know, that's an analogy that maybe people use. It's like a wave. Think, I am wave. I am different from ocean. I'm traveling, I'm affected by the wind. So pick your analogy. But the point is that some characteristics, not some, say all the characteristics exist in us, that is what we call in God or in the soul. Now let's reflect on what are those characteristics. And then we'll come back to the question, how can we learn those? How can we realize those? Soul is have infinite wisdom. Why we go to God? We think God knows everything, right? That's the characteristic we put. That's why we come to God. And when we are troubled, where do we go? We go to prayers, we go to pray God, or we go to someone who we think are closer to God. We call them saints, mystics, or wise people. And we go to them and we feel that they will get the guidance from them. The truth is that you are also there, but that we are not realized enough. Unlimited wisdom is one characteristic that we already have. Unlimited love is another characteristic. Infinity, and when I say unlimited, infinite, there is no boundary. So what does it mean that you are already infinitely wise? You shouldn't have to have any questions. You shouldn't have any questions, right? In the way the scripture, they describe in one of the verse, if you want to describe soul, it said, what is it by knowing which you know everything? What is it? That's how the question was put to explain who we are. What is it by knowing which you would know everything? And some practical people may think, well, that's almost impossible. How can you know everything? But the saints and mystics said, yes, you can know everything. Because you actually know everything already. One more characteristic is compassion, talked about love. Unlimited love, unlimited fearlessness. Fearless, completely fearless. Soul is fearless. Why? Why is that fearlessness is important?
It cannot be created again or cannot be destroyed.
Cannot be destroyed. It cannot be harmed. It cannot be changed. In Bhagavad Gita it says you cannot cut it, you cannot burn it, you cannot part it, you cannot change it. It's unchangeable. It's timeless. It's timeless. There is no effect of time on it. So what is there to fear? Usually what we fear about? Losing? Fear of losing something or someone? Or fear of dying? What's the fear of dying is one of the highest fear. The other fear is coming on the stage and speaking. I had to work on that about 15 years ago. I had to practice it. I was not able to, my legs will tremble and all kinds of fears will happen. So fears that exist out there in us. Why do fear exist? Anyone know the root cause of fear? Well, one is that we think that something will be taken away.
Confidence?
Lack of confidence or confidence? Lack of confidence, okay.
Insecurity.
Insecurity?
Ignorance.
Who said ignorance? Yeah, great. Ignorance.
Body consciousness.
Well, ignorance leads to all of this. Ignorance leads to, I don't know who I am. I don't know what my powers are. So I don't know if I am permanent. I know I'll get, looks like I may get destroyed if I don't do something. People are out there to get me. What kinds of fear exists in us? We call ignorance. If you know who you are, if you know your soul, there is no reason for you to fear. Nobody can take anything away from you. If you knew it, there would not be any fear. So these are the characteristics, and there's some other characteristics. There are others, but I think let's focus on these four or five. Unlimited wisdom. Now remember, wisdom is different from knowledge of the word. The wise people doesn't mean they know everything like from the physical information perspective. Do you know the average temperature in Tanzania? Probably 99.999% may not know what that is. Maybe she knows, she's from Tanzania. No? What is the average temperature in Tanzania? I'm just asking a random question, because this unlimited wisdom doesn't mean you know the answer. But wisdom is basically knowing what you really need to know in order to get to where you need to get. Wisdom is also the knowledge that protects us from the fears of the world. Wisdom is also makes us compassionate, that we are all one. So those are the knowledge and wisdom we're talking about. We're not talking about wisdom as knowledge. The knowledge is, there are two types of knowledge. One is the knowledge of the world, which we call Aparavidya, which means the information. Who is the current president of the United States of America? I'm sure you all know that. That's Aparavidya. That, the knowledge of that kind of nature changes over the time. It doesn't remain the same. It constantly changes. You have to constantly up-to-date yourself. If you watch the news after 4 or 5 years, your answer would likely be wrong. But there's another knowledge called Paravidya, which is the knowledge of the beyond. We call it beyond actually just because they are beyond the senses. You cannot know these knowledge of the senses, what we call the inner knowledge. Actually, that knowledge is much closer. So the para is a kind of a ironic word. You know, when you say para means something beyond, far, something mystical. But actually, how close you are to your soul. You're closer than your own breath. Even the breath is far. So the soul and you are actually one, so how can you be separate, right? So knowledge of the soul, or we call knowledge of God, or knowledge, it's called self-realization, God-realization. Realizing that we are soul is what knowledge we're looking for. And by knowing your soul, you know everything that you need to know. And you get all those characteristics, what we call the characteristics in great leaders. So what are we leading here? The leadership that, bringing back to the leadership we're talking about is not changing others. That's, okay. We're talking about changing ourselves. Transforming self is the true leadership. And why there's so much focus from the saints and mystics? This is a quote from Swami Ram Tirth, who said, transformers are needed, transformation is needed, but of the self, not others. And why did he say that? Why did he say that? How do you transform others? Can you transform others? Anyone can raise your hand and say, yeah, we can transform others. Can we transform others?
We can advise.
We can advise. We can suggest. Can we transform? Can you be transformed in a week or so, please?
It's in their hands.
Transforming ourselves is the most difficult task in the world. Transforming others is impossible. You cannot change others. You cannot change others. Only they can change themselves. And trying to transform others is like drinking poison and hoping that they die. You drink a poison, hope that they die. Is that what happened? Is that like that impossible? Yet, if you look at our lives, and when we talk about leadership, what's our expectation with others? That all these characteristics be in them. They should have this characteristic. They should be more courageous. They should be more risk-taking. They should be more compassionate. They should be more loving. They should be more having a vision. this guy doesn't have a vision. Why doesn't he have a vision? He should have a vision. Can we protest and write a letter to him or her and hope that they will read the letter and get transformed? Is that going to happen? Is anybody here thinks that's going to happen? Well, nobody's raising your hand. So, but yet we spend our life trying to change others. We wake up in the morning, and those who are married, we think that our wife, hopefully that wife will be loving, or their husband will be working better, listening. Or the kids, oh my goodness, hope they get the better grades. And our list goes on and on and on. Does anybody has a list of people that they want to change? We all have, right? Is that true? This is an honest reflection. We have a list of people that we hope transform very soon. And we really believe it. That yes, they will transform. And yet we forget that the person that you can transform, and the only person you can transform, is yourself. In fact, even you cannot transform yourself. You can only put yourself in a pose or in a position where you can be transformed. What transforms us is the grace. And we'll talk about that. But at least that's the influence we know. So if we know that we can only do that, then let us focus on only that aspect. We're not here to say, oh, I'm going to change this person or that person. The spirituality is exactly that. It is about transforming yourself. And yes, it looks very selfish. It looks like, oh my goodness, I'm just trying to transform myself. Am I not being selfish? Am I being like self-centered? It's kind of, isn't it contradictory? Many times we feel that I should be helping others out there. But truly speaking, imagine that you have some physical ailment and you go to a doctor and you have choices of two doctors. One who believes that there should be good doctors out there but is not a good enough doctor. You're getting my point, right? And the one who's already transformed, who's really already a great doctor. Who would you go to? You'll go to both of them? Say it again, Claude.
I said, this medical system of getting protein is always good.
Exactly. Maybe you may not have that choices. You may not even have choices. You are given. But if you had a choice, that's why it's a hypothetical situation. If you had a choice, you would go to someone who is already good, right? Now, that's our choice. We have choice to transform ourselves, but we satisfy ourselves with the one which hopes that one day I'll transform. And we don't choose to transform ourselves. It's that spirituality is that first step. Peace begins with me. The divinity begins with me. I have to take that action. I have to transform myself. And I have to start somewhere, wherever we are, we have to start transforming. Remember, we already are. So what is the process of transformation we're talking about? If you want to be helping others, you would rather put yourself in a position where you can do help better, rather than just trying to help whatever you are, right? You would like to bring all those characteristics so you can influence others. Because remember, Jagdish said that observe Sant Kripal Singh Ji Maharaj, one of the spiritual masters of the last century. He said, spirituality cannot be taught, it cannot be bought, it can only be caught from those or from that person who is already enlightened. Already enlightened. That's the only way you can get it. There is no other way. Now, there are lots of books. I totally agree. The books are there. So don't ignore them. Read them. That's a great start. Because that gives you some direction that somebody enlightened exists that can write so much. But truly speaking, if you want to observe, if you want to learn something, you have to catch or observe someone who is already enlightened. There is no other way. you tell me if there is another way, I'm happy to go with you. That is what the saints told, that's what the masters told, and that's the observation. That you, the only way you can catch it, not through classes, not through these, not through a, you know, spirituality.com or inspiration.com or whatever you think that there exists out there. It can only be caught by observing. And when you observe, you have to be in the physical presence. Digital observation doesn't help much. Digitally, you are only getting the images and the audio and the video. But there is something happen in the physical presence when you're interacting with them, or at least you interact at the same time. When you are in the company of the enlightened being, and when you are receptive, when you have the question in your mind, how am I going to realize my true nature? I really need help. When we are humble, and then we are receptive. And then only in that position, the transfer of the inspiration happen. Because what is happening really is that the spiritual masters are like mirrors. And you can see your true nature in them. There's a story. There was a Chinese king. You know, in China, they're very artistic. You know, there are many people who are follow the art, and this king was very art savvy. So he used to do an annual art festival, and he used to invite artists from all over the world and say, you demonstrate your art, and we'll pick the best art and we'll give the biggest reward. So he would invite many artists, and these artists will come in the preparation, and there will be festive environment because their art will be displayed, and a lot of millions of people will come and see the art, so it's a great festival. And so the artists will come many, many days and weeks before and will start preparing their art right there. And so there were a lot of artists who came to this Chinese King's Festival. And they started, somebody was sculpture, somebody was painting, somebody was building some beautiful piece of art which is made of wood. There were many, many artists. You know all the artists. Somebody was singing, music, so all kinds of artists were there. And the king set a date, and he would observe to see how things are going, and he would observe, make a tour and say, okay, are people, are making progress into his art? And he would see. And he would see people are building their art, so like they started building their sculptures. So one of the guys who started building a wall, still like a simple wall of bricks. So he came to the first and he said, okay, looks like this guy is going to do something on the wall. So the king came after a few more weeks, and he saw that everybody was making progress in their art. They were getting closer, and you could start seeing what they're making. This guy had still the wall, and he was just cleaning the wall. So the king came one more last time, and he saw he was still cleaning the wall. And everybody was getting very close, and you can almost see, and the king would get an idea as to what was going on. Final day came, and he said, what's this guy doing? He's just constantly cleaning the wall. When is he going to do the art, actually? And the day came, and the king said, okay, now unveil whatever the final art you have. And he saw beautiful arts all the way, and he asked this person to show his wall, or whatever he had. So there was a curtain in front of the wall, so he removed the curtain. Guess what he saw? Anyone? Yeah. He was cleaning the wall, until it got so polished that it was reflecting whatever was in front of it. So the king, when he was standing in the whole grandiose in front of the wall, he saw himself. And he said, that was the greatest art. That showed me who I am. And that's the kind of art that the saints and mystics have. They teach you how to polish your mind, how to still your mind, how to cleanse your mind, in which then you can see the reflection of your soul, not your soul, reflection of you. Remember, you are the soul, the true self. When you see the reflection of you, when your mind is still, when your mind is cleansed, you see God. You are God. You just don't know it because our attention is out there in the physical world. we are engrossed in the sensory knowledge, the pursuit of information. We think the cell phones are God now. We can't live without them. We have to have a cell phone to look at our emails, to text someone, to connect people, to Google, to download an app that does whatever the best thing you want to do. But we lost touch with our soul, our own soul, which is the greatest tool. Our mind is the greatest tool. It's a, unfortunately, our mind is like a great servant, but a very, very bad master. It's like the fire. When the fire is in control, you can do good things with it, right? You can cook food, you can run cars, you can run the whole economy in a proper direction. You can work the whole universe, right? When the fire is in your control. But when the fire is out of control, what happens? It destroys. It destroys, and so our mind is like that. When the mind is in control, when it is a servant, it does the best for you. It listens to you. And who are you again? The soul. The analogy that our scriptures and our masters have given is like a chariot. They said the senses are like horses. And the rein of the horses is with the mind. The senses are like horses. They want to run. They want to run. We want to see things. We want to hear good things. We want to eat good food. We want to smell good. We want all the good stuff always. These are constantly pulling us outward. The horses are constantly pulling. The reins of this is in our mind's hand. If a mind can control the senses, they can be directed to the right direction for your benefit. But when the horses are out of control, what happens? You know, one is going this way, one is going this way. The mind is sitting in the middle doing nothing. We don't know how to control these horses. And who's the passenger? That's true you, that's the soul. That's the passenger. When the soul has given its control to mind, to say, okay, right, take me from the prayer that we talked about, back to the prayer that we had. Lead me from ignorance to knowledge. Lead me from ignorance or untruth to truth. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from cycles of death to immortality. That's the soul's direction to mind. I'm stuck in this cage of karma. Oh, my physical human body and human mind, take me. And then what happens? Look, when you were born, imagine, or you remember when you were born? You may not remember when you were born, but maybe you remember somebody else born when you were a little bit bigger. And when the child is born, what are they? Reflection of purity, right? They're so pure. They're full of love. Just pure joy, right? We consider them divine. We take care of them. Because they don't have any judgment. They don't see, oh, this person is good, this person is not so good. You know, I don't like to be in this company. They just joy all the time, no matter what. And reflect on that. That is our start of the journey as human being. But then what happened? You look into yourself in the mirror recently. Is that the same joy? What happened? We got enamored by the word. We got enamored by the fears. We forgot. It is said that even if a child is still aware of who the child is. But when over the time, you start showing them lullaby and you start showing them things. Look, this is the toy. This is your toy. That is red. This is your mom. This is your this, your that. And now, from infinite wisdom, to we come to the smaller wisdom. This is mine. We become like limited. And that's what we are. So we started the journey and we had this hope that this in the human birth we get to our goal, that we realize God. It is the only reason why the human birth is given to the soul. If we pass this birth, we're back to the cycles of life and you could be anything. Now I know some people believe that they will be human being all the time, but good luck. Hopefully. We cannot guarantee that we will come back as human being. Our next world depends on what kind of desires we have. If you die, there was a story of King Bharat who died, he was a spiritual person, died with an attachment to a deer, and then he became deer. So our, wherever we are attached, that's where our mind will lead us to. So it is important that we become desireless, and as human birth, we become desireless in order to realize ourselves. Then we walk towards an enlightened being. We have to find an enlightened being. How do we find an enlightened being? Now I know this is a great question that people say, how do I find a guru? The answer to that question given by the master himself is, don't worry about finding a guru. Just seek the truth. All you need to do is seek God. The guru is already awake. We are sleeping, we are a human, common human being. We are not aware of God, but God is watching us, right? He's already awake. The master is connected with the God, enlightened being is connected with God, is already awake. He will find it, or she will find it, doesn't matter the gender. So all we need to do is to seek the truth about ourselves. If you seek it sincerely, if you look at your prayers, how many people have prayed here regularly? You pray? What do you pray for? You pray for your family, you pray for your well-being, you pray for your health, you pray for, you know, some others, sometimes some people may even pray for other people as well. How many times you pray for God alone? Very few. That's the right kind of prayer. And then we need to reflect our prayer. Now you go back home and just ask yourself, what am I praying for? When you pray sincerely, when the student is ready, the teacher appears in front of you. You will not have to go far. And that's the law of nature. It's not that you have to find the teacher and you have to go to Himalayas or go into the jungle and look for a person who's enlightened. It's not gonna happen. Even if you're looking, if you don't ask for the right things, if your prayer is to be a millionaire, who will you find as a guru? Another millionaire?
Financial advisor.
What?
Financial advisor.
A tax consultant maybe? Who will become a millionaire, but then he'll keep you below, right? It's what you seek is what you get. That's one of the characteristics that we are God. God has given us freedom to ask whatever we want. And what do we ask for? We ask for like candies and little things here and little things there, and we pass all of our life. We think that is good enough for us to have good health and good kids and good family, good spouse, a good house, a working car. And anything goes wrong with that, we get worried, we start praying. Oh my goodness, my kid has got B+. That's bad. I lost with that. Still go through that sometimes. His kids are still in school. So I'm not saying you don't worry about it. I'm sure you need to take action. But was that the highest prayer we have? What is our highest prayer? Look at your prayer. When you see God, you will get God. But the cost of God is our bottomless desires. We have to give up our desires of the world. We cannot say, God, I want you, but I want you in Rameshwaram. Meet me there. I'm getting there. Or any other place that you've been. That's not going to happen. If you really want to visit tourist places or nice, beautiful nature, you will get there. You will not get God. You have to ask for God and God alone. And where do you have to go? Within. He's right there. He's right there for you, waiting with open arms. You just don't have time to go and meet. So meditation is that process by which we withdraw our attention from the outer world and focuses within. And what's the role of the master? The master is that inspiration, is the role model. He's actually tell you through his personal interaction who you are and then help you get there. Now, the spiritual master are the only perfect teachers in the universe. Why they are perfect teachers? If you want to win a Grand Slam in tennis or World Cup in soccer, whatever you pick the highest physical goal, and you go to the coach and say, would you guarantee me that I'll get there? Would they guarantee you? Nobody can guarantee you. Nobody can guarantee, except for spiritual master. The spiritual master says, if you, as long as you follow my commandment, I will get you there. There is no better teacher than an enlightened being. Because they, the only condition they ask for is that you have to be wanting it. Sincerely wanting it. When you sincerely look for those characteristics, you already have it. He's a mirror, he will show you. And he will help you clean the mirror. He'll help you clean the dust. He's not saying I'm giving you anything. He's just saying you already are. I'm just helping you cleanse yourself. Your mind. You know, Kabir, who was 500 years back, a saint, he said, Kabira man nirmal bhaya, jaise ganga neer, paache paache hari phire, kahat kabir kabir. He said, if your heart and your mind is cleansed, then the God is going to chase you. You don't have to go for God. God will chase you down. Okay, I have to be. This is my guy. This is my child. But unfortunately, we think that we are the poor ones, and wherever we are, the God needs to come. We have created so many walls around us that God cannot enter. We have walls of ego, that I am different. We have walls of desires, that I want this and I want that. We have walls of separation, duality. We have to break down those walls. We have to get rid of those desires. And we have to meditate. And meditation helps us cleanse that mind. It is the only practical thing you can do. I know that a lot of people say, oh, I can be inspired by listening to someone. That is all great. You have to sit down. How do you clean your house? You have to pick up a vacuum, pick up a broom and do it. You don't just hope. Sitting outside, you hope that somebody will clean my home one day. You have to do it yourself. And this is not something you can contract. Maybe house you can. You can contract with someone, 100 cleaners, whatever. But for you, your mind, you are the only person who can enter there. Only person, not your spouse, not your identical twins, not your children, not your parents. They can only be well-wisher for you. Only you can do it. The only practical thing you can do is sit down and meditate. So let us sit. This is an art or technique that is freely given by the saints, because they are well-wishers. They are truly well-wishers. How much time do you have? Okay, we have time. We have 11:24. We have to finish in 20 minutes. I would like to propose that we sit for 10 minutes for meditation. And then Ashwini will give all the instructions so you can practice at home. So please sit as comfortably as you can. Turn off your phones or any distractions you may have. You have to sit relaxed. And can someone get light for me? We're going to meditate with you and then I'll open the floor question and answer. If anybody has questions, we'll address those. So please sit comfortably as you can. Close your eyes. Look straight ahead. Why you look straight ahead? It's because our eyes physically need to be still. The only time they are still is they are relaxed in front. The truly what is happening is when you look straight ahead and your eyes are closed in a relaxed pose, it's the third eye where your attention is automatically lifted. It's the source. The seat of the soul. Thank you. So start withdrawing your attention from the feet. Just relax your feet because our attention is just spread out in the body in general. And we're all going to collect it at the seat of the soul. So start withdrawing from our feet. Relax your leg. Just make sure there's no tension in them. Relax your waist, your back. Just make sure there's a position where you can sit for next 10 minutes. Relax your shoulders. Carry a lot of burden unnecessarily. You can leave it on God now. Relax your neck. Relax your face. Don't worry. God will come to you. Great things will come to you. Just relax. You can bring a small smile that relaxes all the muscles of your face. You don't want any distraction. Now gaze in front of you with your eyes closed, as if you're looking at a very distant point with your physical eyes. But physical eyes are not the ones we see. It's the single or third eye located between behind the eyebrows, known as Shivnetra Chakra, or single eye. There are many names to it. Essentially, it's a spiritual eye that looks back inward towards our soul. Initially, you'll see darkness. That darkness is caused by our mind. Our mind is like muddy water. It blocks the light. Just like the fog was left blocking the light today. It's foggy. It's blocking the light. You keep gazing in the middle. You repeat a mantra. You can say Om, peace, love, or whatever word of God that fits your faith or belief. Repeat it gently in your mind. It keeps the mind occupied. Slowly the darkness will disappear. Slowly you'll start seeing some light. What is happening is that mind is start stilling. The mind stops getting stimulation from the senses. And when that happens, it starts stilling. And by repeating mantra, we stop it from analyzing and thinking. Now your mind may still wander away into the thoughts, sometimes about the past or about the future. But gently bring it to the present moment. And the way you do that is start focusing back on your repetition and gazing. With time, you will have experiences, inner experiences. You will see light, you may see other inner vistas. Whatever is good for you, you will experience. All you need to do is be there. We'll meditate for 5 to 7 more minutes, and I'll get your meditation back. Then gently, please become aware of the world around you, give meditation. I hope you had a good meditation. I know it's sample, it's not real. The reason is it takes time, maybe at least 15-20 minutes to still remain. But if you, has anybody had good meditation here? No? One? Okay. Any question that came to your mind? I'm happy to answer those. Any question that came to you as a technique? Is there a challenge or difficulty in your meditation?
Wandering around.
Oh, you're unique. No, that's very common. The mind's nature is to wander because it doesn't know where to stay. The mind is looking for change. It only knows change. So it's the change is its home. So anytime you ask it to still, it says, where's my home? I'm not my home, so I need to be my home. And it's constantly looking for change. So since the mind is a good, if it is a good servant, we can tell it to do, instead of letting go here and there, some of the technique allow that, we just give a mantra so it repeats and stays there. So it feels that it's going. You know, it's like your child who wants to go and sit in a horse and go somewhere, you put him in a carousel and you can watch them. So the mind is like given something to do. It feels that it is running because it is so used to running, cannot stop. You know, I wish we could realize that how bad it is that the mind has to keep running. Imagine if you had a car that doesn't stop. What would you do? It doesn't stop. You got to some way put it in a circle or something so that you can get out of it, right? This is exactly what mind is doing to you. So the circle is basically the simran or the repetition of God's name or mantra. And it's a very ancient technique. Even if you're not meditating, you can practice it. So when you practice it all day long, when you sit for meditation, the mind says, okay, now I know what to do. I'll just go in a circle, mantra. The second aspect of that is also you remember God. So when you remember God, your attention goes towards the divinity. You know, the God channel is always within you. It's the channel that we don't watch. Our remote skips that channel usually. It goes to temple, and then it goes to the social part, boom, you miss the God. So we have to still at that level to remembering God or any godly attribute, and therefore physical master helps us a tremendous way. That's why when people have a spiritual master or enlightened being, they don't have to worry about, oh, how do I think about the God? You can just think about the master, because the master is connected to the God, you automatically connect to God. The masters are the ones which can help our attention get tuned to God channel. So that's another way of stilling the mind. But there's no other shortcut other than practicing for meditation. You have to sit for meditation. And recommended time, I'm sure you're asking this question in your mind or not, opening up, how long you should meditate. You should meditate as long as you can. Start small, add slowly. You will not believe, even if you add, let's say, half a minute every day. Half a minute every day. Start with like 5 minutes and add half a minute every day. Now I'm sure many of you are good in math. What will be your meditation time on a year? Anyone? It's almost 3 hours. 3 hours plus, right? Half a minute a day is not a big deal. Like drop, every drop counts. But if you meditate someday 5 minutes, and then you meditate after 3 months, and then you meditate after 2 weeks, and then you meditate for 2 hours, and then you forget about it, it doesn't help. It's like, you don't eat food like that, right? You know that you need to eat little, but every day, and good quantity and good quality, right? Similarly, meditation. You have to do meditation regularly. Regularly, small amount that you can do. Don't try something you can't do, and then you give up. That's not good. But add a little every day. Just half a minute, a week, fine. Okay, that's fine. A minute a week. Go to 5 minutes or 6 minutes next week. You still get 52 minutes added, or, right? In a year. That means you'll go to almost an hour in a year. So the spiritual masters recommend, that's what my son, Rajinda Siddhi Maharaj, my teacher, he recommends 10% of time given to spirituality. That's a lot, not a lot of time. We sleep 8-9 hours. That's a third of our life. And we work 8-9 hours. That's another third of life. And the rest of the time goes in maintenance of our body. We have no time for soul. So we have to find some time. He says 10%, not more. 10%, two and a half hours. But that's, even to get to 2.5 hours, you'll have to practice, okay? So start with 5 minutes, that's okay, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. If you meditate 15 minutes, you will stay inspired because you'll get some stillness. You will experience some physical benefit. You'll experience some mental benefit. You'll start feeling calmer. You'll start getting more focused at your work or at your home. You will experience that you don't get angry so easily. You'll experience that other people don't influence you that much. You're able to be still. So that happens even with 15 minutes of meditation a day. But then as you increase it, you start seeing the other benefits. Not just the physical, mental, but the spiritual benefits. You start seeing yourself different. You start having compassion. You start seeing others are also divine. And you become greater understanding. What you usually reject people, like, oh, maybe that's not a good idea. You start wondering, no, actually, that has a point. Actually, they're my friend, not my foe. I mean, how bad it is if we have a friend and we just don't recognize it, right? So you start recognizing your true friends, and you start spending time. I will just say 3 things if you get out of this storm. Is number one, you are soul, and therefore you're part of God. You're not God yet, but you are God, you just have forgotten yourself. That's number one. Number two, that you can realize that. You can change and transform yourself. Only you can do it. Nobody else can do it for you, and you cannot do someone else. And how you do it? Simple steps. Meditate regularly. Find an enlightened being. In order to find an enlightened being, you gotta pray sincerely. And the right things will happen, and the master will find you. And then third is good company. Satsang. Or once you find the master, actually, that's the true company that you really want. But meanwhile, be with the people who are spiritually minded. Because if you spend time in the soccer field and you hope that you will be a swimmer, that's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's just science. Right? One thing is spirituality is common sense. There is no blind faith anywhere. It is pure common sense. It just makes sense if you really reflect on it. The problem is we don't have time, enough time, we're busy with the nonsense of the physical world. So, putting your time in a meditation, sincerely praying, and spending time with the spiritual minded people will help you transform yourself. And the third is, you can only make an effort. The true transformation happens with the divine grace. You know, I'm so grateful that I'm getting the opportunity to be here and do some my seva, the selfless service. Selfless service start from you. You can start helping others. Help others. If you make someone else happy, that's the secret of being happy yourself. It's simple. It's very simple. You feel the happiness will come from me when I have this car or the house. It doesn't happen. It lasts very short time. The true happiness, lasting happiness, it's already within you. When you start sharing with others, you realize that you have it. You know, if you start giving your money to your other people, you see your bank balance going down, right? So you don't want to do that. But when you start sharing love, it starts going up. And you experience that. And what beautiful way that God has given us is that when we share, it increases. That's love. So give others. And I'm so grateful that God has already given us a platform where we can start. We don't have to start from scratch. We don't have to start back to zero. Already there is so much is available. We just have to be willing to go forward from there. We got human birth. We're on the best planet in the universe, that as far as we can see. We got oxygen. We got food. We got shelter. Even in Minnesota, we can live and survive. We have heaters. We have knowledge. We make money enough to survive ourselves. All now we need is to put our attention on the right goal that is for which we are born as human being. That's the only reason we are born as human being, is to realize yourself. You realize yourself, God realization will definitely follow. So this is the opportunity. Just start working on it. Real grace happens. You're already graced with so many things. Your next grace is you coming in contact with an enlightened being. The next grace is that you realizing that you are that already. So, any other question? Yes?
I know you said like books, self-knowledge, but I'm just wondering, what sort of books do you recommend in reading just to kind of enhance your knowledge on soul?
Yes, we have a few books. Repeat the question. What are the books out there to kind of get more knowledge about this? We have a couple of books. I have a couple of books I can show you. This is Empowering Your Soul for Meditation and Inner and Outer Peace. We have a Spark of the Divine. In fact, we are doing a book study group. We haven't met for a while, but we plan to continue, which allows us. We have a wonderful program. So we are book studying, so you're welcome to join that book study. We kind of read the book, and that's how I know him. It's great way. So those books are great, Spark of the Divine. There are many books out there, but I recommend these few because I know they're
really
good.
Yeah.
There are many, and that's another challenge with the old senses. You know, you get lost in the analysis of what's the better book, and then
right.
And then you forget that you have to learn something. Doesn't matter actually, all the knowledge is within you.
Right.
So whatever helps you reflect is the right book for you. You will read a few pages and know, okay, that's making sense. You know, it has to make common sense, that's all. There is no magic. There is no shortcut. You gotta work for it. Any other question? Well, technically, yes, sir.
When I meditate, it clouds smoke.
In your eyes?
Inside.
So when you meditate, you feel like there are clouds? That's a very good experience, I would say. It's a great experience because you are seeing something with your inner eye. You know, even if you're seeing darkness, at least you're seeing something because your attention is there. If you're not seeing anything, what the worst meditation is, you sit for meditation, you close your eyes, and then you are thinking about the work, and you're thinking about the home, and your family, and a football match, and what we're going to shop tomorrow or today, and then you 10 minutes are gone, and then you get up and say, oh, I don't know, what was I doing? I was just thinking all the time. It's called thinkitation. But if you're seeing something, the color, that's great because that's a reflection of the inner light. The colors are not important, but if you're seeing something, that's a great experience. So just keep looking in the middle of that, keep your mind and attention there, and keep repeating the name of God so your attention doesn't run away. If you find yourself thinking, just gently bring in looking into that, whatever it is happening. And slowly that will, it may take weeks, months, years sometime, and if you're lucky it may happen tomorrow. You can't put any scale to it, unfortunately. But whenever is the right time for you, that slowly the light will keep increasing. And it is a reflection that our mind is getting stiller. Interesting, one more thing I'll answer for you is, meditation just doesn't happen for the time you sit. Meditation is a way of life. You have to be thinking about yourself as soul, or you have to remember God all day long. And that's why you find these ancient people repeating God's name all day long. They knew the technique, just stilling the mind, because they don't want to think about anything. If you think about anything, your attention goes there. So if you can repeat God's name, if you make your life ethical and moral ethical life, just be nonviolent. I think nonviolence is the greatest thing. Just don't hurt others. Simple. Don't do things that you don't want others to do to you. Golden rule. That's simple. It's not like a very complicated, what is right, what is wrong. Just don't hurt others and don't do things that you don't want others to do. And that's a simple golden rule of ethics that applies to all religions and all faiths, and no matter, even if you don't believe in God, you can live mid that standard, right? So living a good, simple human life of nonviolence and purity and truth, humility, and practicing meditation regularly. And then remember God. The God channel is always going on when you're driving, you're walking. You can remember God. Just repeat the name of God and let it work on it. Because you're not doing actually, you're just allowing yourself to open, you're like opening the arms and the gift will come to you. So does that help you?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes?
I just want to make a comment that as you discussed that helps to develop the traits, it helps in leadership.
Yes, so Ashwini is my life, keep me on the track. So thank you. Basically, what is it going to happen is that spirituality or finding yourself as soul is not only going to help you, but when you become peaceful, you naturally start influencing others. When you have a clear vision of yourself, automatically people will come to you, okay, how can you be so calm and quiet? How can you be so peaceful and happy? What's going on? And you start helping others. And so that is a true leadership in my view. I think we need more and more peaceful people who can influence other, again, through their behavior, not through the lecture. People see and observe more than what they hear, right? So just be who you are, you truly are soul, and you can meditate. You are actually starting the changing world. And if you can influence one family, your family can influence the community can influence the country, and the country can influence the world. And so this is the path to world peace. But it starts with you. So that's the true leadership in a way. And that makes you become more selfless, and you start helping. And your art could be anything, your skill could be anything. You start using that to help others. If you're an artist, you draw art, you write the books, if you're an author, you write kind of books. If you're an engineer, you build the right things. If you are, whatever doctor, you start helping with the help. So it's a state of mind where you help others. So you with the spirituality, you come to that state where you're naturally selfless. And guess what? Even if 10% of the people in the world become selfless, this world would be a better place to live, don't you think? So is that... Yes. Any other question on meditation training? Yes.
Just want to switch topics. You started the talk with leadership, and there's a flow of thought in the materialistic world that either you're born leader or you're not.
Uh-huh.
Any thoughts on that?
Well, we are all born souls. So as a soul, we have all the characteristics that if you're a human being, you already have all the characteristics. The other worldly characteristics that people think, like, can I influence others easily? Can I impress someone easily? Or when I speak, the words come to me where crowd gathers. Those are all illusions. Those are not the reality. Because guess what? You can get there and you will not have any of the spiritual traits I'm talking about. And you know what I'm talking about. You could be there in front of the public and you could be, you can become a visible leader, but are you a true leader? We're talking about true leadership, and that exists in each and every human being. So our reflection is on the aspect that we all can do. Yes, we can. Absolutely we can. We have to be wanting to do it. The traits that people talk about, born leaders and all that, those are all the outer traits which are kind of good looking good, you know. They're not real. If you dig deeper, you'll find something selfless in them. That's what impresses. If you find some of them more calm, more peaceful, that's what impresses. So we focus on those aspects which are the true aspects of leadership. So Gandhiji said, you know, if you want to make the change, be the change yourself, and that's what we're doing. Any other question? And I'd like to give some information about our center. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm here. I will hang around here for a few minutes. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. But we have meditation opportunity in this temple itself every Sunday morning, 9 o'clock. We are doing this meditation study group also. And now I know we are kind of irregular. Hopefully we'll get regular soon. We have so temple is a great place to meditate. Whenever you want, there's a meditation room. That's another opportunity. Our room is doing a great job of inviting speakers and with Vishal. Come here 10:30, that's a great opportunity also for you to meditate. But we have a meditation center in Columbia Heights in Minneapolis, which is also open twice a week, all every Friday evening and alternate Sunday, first and third. You're invited to come there and visit. That center is meant only for meditation. So meditation and meditative way of life. And very interestingly, we practice the selflessness, we practice, and there's a beautiful community that helps us grow spiritually. So I invite you to come to the center. Ashwini is going to give you some quick handouts. I want you to take something home, right? Simple technique, that's all I have. And this is free. It's available, free of charge to everyone. I'm also going to give my cards to anyone who needs it. We'll have the address of the center and the time. And if you haven't given your emails, please make sure you give it to Arun so he can keep you informed of all the great programs we have here in the temple. And hopefully we can send a sales information also. We are actually conducting classes right now in the center every Wednesday. And we're going to have a family meditation camp on 4th of March. It's free. So if you you have children, grandchildren, nephews, nieces, whatever, and bring them and you come along with them. Because it's for the whole family. So it's 4th of March, Saturday, 9 to 5. And you'll find more information on the website there. Any questions? Yes, please, could you take this?
I have a question on what you said. What you said, the analogy that you gave, right? If you have a illness, who would you go to? You go
right.
To a doctor.
Right.
That you know already, quote unquote, enlightened.
Right.
Or you go to a doctor who wants the world to be enlightened, but is not necessarily like that.
Correct.
If you relate back to the practical world, if you look at work, if you look at the workplace, I tend to think that not necessarily okay if you are a manager or a director or a vice president at your people. But you find more often than not that there are people who are so knowledgeable that right? They have the answers to your questions.
Right.
One of the difficulties might be.
Right.
And they tend to become leaders naturally.
Yes.
Right? So to me, in a practical sense, that is important, right? If you know. And again, one to call it enlightenment or knowing
yes.
The wisdom part, right? That's important. So in my mind, I think that's how I come to a lot of mentors. In principle, they will not necessarily be leaders by their position. But they're leaders because of their knowledge and their wisdom.
You
see this all the time. You spend a lot of time there. You see this stuff.
Right.
They said something, you had a difficulty.
I agree.
Discussion was going to them, but they didn't do it. Right.
No, that's absolutely right. So your comment is that there are people in the world who impress us and who are knowledgeable. And some people are knowledgeable in one area, some people are knowledgeable in another area, but you won't find people who know everything. So that's the challenge of the world is we need to look, when we see these teachers, we absolutely can learn traits that you, and if that's what you want to learn, absolutely go to them. Because a spiritual master is not going to teach you how to manage a project or you know, how to make a good meal for the housewife, or, you know, those things you have to go to the right place to learn. So the spirituality doesn't tell you that stop learning from everybody else. It actually inspires you to see what you need to learn and then learn from them. And you look at the right kind of traits to learn. You don't want to get impressed with their flashiness, but you see the sincerity, like, okay, what is that? And how do I get there, really? It's not that they impress me by answering my question, but what is that that I can also do? So this is about transforming, not about following, right? So yes, if you need to follow, and every good leader is a very humble person too. They are good students also. And so you'll invariably find them, like Abdul Kalam Azad, you know, our ex-president, I think great leader. He was so humble. He said, I'm a student at the age of 84, you know, and he would, that's the kind of person, I would say, and you learn the traits that we shared at the beginning. What are the traits? You know, courage, vision, clarity of vision, and having a selfless service attitude. And those are the things you learn. You don't look at necessarily, oh, look at this beautiful painting this person draw, or how successful, you know, he became. Because some of the successes are temporary. So we don't focus on the temporariness but the permanence. Okay, thank you very much. I think we're out of time. Thank you very much for listening, and if there is any mistake, my apologies, I'm still a student and learning. And I'll be happy to take your feedback and advice. Thank you.